Hello students. So students, today we are starting with the ninth chapter of your syllabus, and the name of this chapter is Morphology of Flowering Plants. So basically in this chapter we are going to study the morphology of angiosperms. Okay, so let us start this chapter by understanding what are angiosperms. So we know that Earth, it has a wide diversity of plants. And some of these plants are non-flowering ones and some of them are the flowering ones. Okay, and the angiosperms are known to be the flowering ones. Now these flowering plants, they actually dominate the world of plants. Why do they dominate? Because they have a well adapted nature to the environmental conditions. Now on the basis of their habitat, that means on the basis of where they grow, the angiosperms, they can be classified into different types. The first type is hydrophytes. Hydro means water. So the angiosperms or the flowering plants that can grow in water, or you can say nearby to water bodies, they are called as hydrophytes. Now hydrophytes are also further classified into submerged hydrophyte, then the free floating hydrophyte, and then there are some anchored hydrophyte. When we say submerged hydrophytes, that means these hydrophyte plants are completely submerged under the water. Okay, so you can say the aquatic ones. Then when we say the free floating ones, that means certain part of these plants are aerial, that means it is in air, and certain parts are below the water body. Then there is anchored hydrophyte. Anchored hydrophyte means the maximum part of this plant is aerial and only they have this a little anchorage into the water body. Okay, so this is hydrophyte plants. Then there are xerophytes. Xerophyte means the plants that are growing in xeric condition. Xeric condition is deserted condition where there is either no water or you can say there is a very little or minimum water. Okay, so all the desert plants, mainly the best example that we take is of cactus. The botanical name of cactus is Opuntia dilani, or it is also called as Nagfani. Commonly it is called as Nagfani. So this is one best example to study the xerophytic plant. Okay, then there is lithophytes. Lithophytes are the plants that grow on rocks and on stones. Okay, so lithos, it means rock, and phytes means plants. So the plants that grow on rocks or on stones, they are called as lithophytes. And the last type is halophytes. Now halophytes are the plants that grow under saline condition, that grows in salty condition or salty habitat. And the example for halophytes are the mangroves. So students, if you have seen or if you have heard about mangroves plant that grow under marshy area, they grow on the creeks, okay, and they grow under marshy area where the condition of the water or the condition of the marsh is saline. It is having a lot of salt deposition. So these are halophytes. And the example for the mangroves or the halophytes that I can give you is Avicennia. So Avicennia is a plant that is considered to be halophytes. So these are the four basic different types of angiosperm that is dependent upon, or it is on the basis of their habitat, or you can say on the basis of where they are grown. Okay, now when we say an angiospermic plant, an angiospermic plant mainly has all the parts of the plant. You will see root system, you will see the stem, the branching of the stem, which will bear some leaves, then some flowers, and also the fruits. Okay, so now further let us study about the roots. The first part of the plant, the angiospermic plant, that is the root. Now root, it is considered to be a descending axis of the plant body, which is positively geotropic and hydrotropic. What do you mean by geotropic or hydrotropic? Geotropic means the roots that grow towards the soil. And hydrotropic means the roots that grow towards a water body. Okay, so roots, they are descending axes of the plant body which are positively geotropic and hydrotropic, but negatively phototropic and areotropic. So now what do you mean by this? When we say positive geotropic or hydrotropic, that means it is going towards the gravity. The roots are growing towards the gravity, that is in the downward position, correct? But negatively phototropic and areotropic means they do not grow towards light, and they do not grow towards the aerial part. They are always below the ground. Okay, so that is what we mean by saying positively geotropic and hydrotropic, and negatively phototropic and areotropic. So now when we see a typical root has all these regions. The first one is the root cap. Every root will have this root cap, which is protective in nature. Then just above the root cap will be a region of meristematic tissue. Now, what are meristematic tissues? Meristematic tissues are the ones that have the ability to divide and redivide. So you can say these are the young cells. The tissue, the meristematic tissue are made up of meristematic cells, which are young cells, and they have the ability to divide and redivide. Just above the meristematic region is the elongation region. Okay, so as the meristematic region divides and redivides, it gives rise to this elongation region. And above the elongation region is the region of maturation. So the tissues which are present in this region, they are, you know, divided for different functions. They will give rise to root hair, they will give rise to different cells of the root. Okay, so these are the four regions, you can say, of a typical root. Now let us now study about the types of root. Now the basic two types of root, on the basis of their origin, they are classified as tap root, or which are also called as true roots, and the adventitious root. So students, if you can see over here, I have attached the picture of both. This is a tap root and this is an adventitious root. What is the basic difference between the two? A tap root will always have a primary root coming out first, and the primary root will give rise to the secondary root. The secondary root will give rise to the tertiary root, and then there may be quaternary roots. Okay, so this is seen in all the dicots. All the dicotyledonous plants, they have the tap root system. The example that they have given is of pea, bean, sunflower. These are all dicot plants. So every dicot plant will show taproot system. Now what do you mean by adventitious root? Adventitious root, they are the ones that show fiber like growth. Okay, so they are always in cluster. Now there is one thing, that the taproot, they develop from the radicle of an embryo during seed germination. This means that when a seed germinates, it will show two parts. It will show a plumule and a radicle. The plumule will give rise to the aerial parts of the plant, that is the stem and then the further growth. And the radicle will always give rise to the root. Okay, so tap root, they are developed from the radical part of the embryo during seed germination. Same goes with adventitious root. They are developed from, there is a difference. Adventitious root, they develop from any other part but not the radicle. Okay, it can be the base of the stem, it can be the nodes, it can be in between the internodes, or it can be from the base of the leaf. So if you see over here, this is an adventitious root. So from the base of the leaf, you will see such fiber-like roots coming out. So they do not have a primary root giving rise to secondary, tertiary and quaternary root. They just have clusters of root which gives an appearance of a fibrous root. So this is the basic difference between the adventitious and the taproot. Okay, where are the fibrous or the adventitious root seen? These are seen in monocots. Okay, so all the monocots like the maize, wheat, sugarcane or coconut, all of them, they have adventitious root system. Okay, so this was about roots. Now after this, let us also study about the modification of roots. Now students, before I start this, Let me tell you that same thing I have been explained, in the demonstrative experiments. I have explained the modification of roots there. Okay, so if you want a detailed explanation, you can refer to that video as well. Now, the modification of root, it has different types. The first one is fusiform root, which is seen in Rafinus sativus, which is commonly called as radish. So now, what do you mean by a fusiform root? Fusiform root means they will have a swollen median part. So if you see, there is a swollen median part and the two ends will be tapering. Okay, so the tapering ends with a swollen median part. This gives an appearance of a spindle shape. So a spindle shaped root is called a fusiform root. Now what is the function of this fusiform root? The function of the fusiform root is for food storage mainly. Okay, so as you know, radish, it is eaten. Okay, it is edible. So the root of the radish, it is edible because the root stores the food which is edible by other people or other organisms. So it is a fusiform root. Next one is fasciculated root. Now what do you mean by fasciculated root? This is fasciculated root, which you commonly see in dahlia plants and asparagus plants. Now they are, in appearance, they are somewhat very similar to the fusiform root, that is the radish. The only difference is that they appear in clusters. Okay, so if you see radish is always, in singles, or they will be sometimes appearing in doubles. But over here, fasciculated root, they are always in cluster. Then comes the respiratory roots. Respiratory roots, the example over here is of pneumatophores. Now what are pneumatophores? Pneumatophores, they are common, it is seen in the mangroves, the example that I gave you in the previous slide of halophytes. So halophytes, which grow under marshy area, saline marshy area, they bear such roots which are called as respiratory roots or pneumatophore roots. Now, why do we call it respiratory roots? So as in the marshy area, there is a lot of salt deposition. It is a very salty and a saline condition. And that condition, it is not very apt for the roots for breathing. Okay, so there is no soil aeration, or you can say there is less soil aeration. Okay, because of that soil deposition or the marshy area. So in such conditions, these mangroves, they form these roots which are called as pneumatophores. So the pneumatophores, they come above the soil level, and through these minute pores, the white color minute pores that you can see on the on the roots, they breathe through these minute pores. Okay, so they appear like a dead man's finger. And these are called as pneumatophores or the respiratory roots. So the examples are, as I told you, Avicennia is one example, and the other example is Rhizophora. So both of these plants, they are considered to be mangroves. The next is stilt root. Stilt root, it is seen in Zea maize, that is your maize plant. Now what is stilt root? They develop from the lower nodes. Okay, so as you know that maize, it is a tall crop. It is a crop plant and it is tall. Okay, now it is tall, so it has to be provided with some anchorage towards the soil. Okay, so that it can upstand very well. Because of this, from the nodes, there are some roots that come out. And after these roots, they reach the soil, they form the anchorage to the soil. Okay. So this is because this is mainly the function for these stilt root is mainly to provide support to this main stem so that it doesn't fall off. Okay, next is epiphytic root, which are also called as clinging root or the aerial root. Now these are seen in orchids. So students, if you have heard about the orchid flowers, so clinging or the epiphytic roots are seen in the orchids, or the botanical name for it is Vanda. So the plants that grow on other plants, or you can say the plants that grow on other trees, they are called as epiphytes. Now these plants that grow on other trees, they do not absorb any kind of nutrition from that tree. Okay, they just require the tree for a support system. So a group of plants called as orchids, they are mainly epiphytes. Okay, now about the roots of these plants, they show aerial roots. So if you can see this, they show aerial root, and these aerial roots, they are produced from the nodes, and they have a special tissue which is called as velamen. Now velamen tissue, they are adapted to absorb atmospheric water and atmospheric nutrition. Okay, so these roots, they have a special kind of tissue. The tissue is called as velamen. The next one is hostorial or sucking roots. Now these are parasitic. Now the one that you can see, the yellow color stem like structure that you can see, these are the parasitic plants. Okay, this is called as the parasitic plant, and the example for this is cascata, or the other name for it is amarvale. So this cascata or amarvale, it is a parasitic plant, and it will grow on the other plant, and it will just, you know, give out these hostorias, or you can say the sucking roots. These hostoria will penetrate into the host plant. It will penetrate through the xylem and the phloem, and then from there it will absorb all the nutrition from this host plant. Okay, so this is hostorial or sucking roots. Now this was all about the roots, where we have studied the typical root structure, types of root, that is taproot and adventitious root, and certain modifications in root, that is the fusiform, fasciculated, respiratory, that is pneumatophores, stilt root, epiphytic root, and hostorial or sucking roots. Now next, let us see about the stems. Stems, they are considered to be the aerial part of the plant body. Okay, so they are known as the shoot system. Now stem, they are the main axis, and they bear the flower, the leaves, the fruits. Correct? Now as said previously, the roots, they appear from the radical region of the germinating seed. So the stem, they develop from the plumule region of the germinating seed. Okay? It is differentiated into nodes and internodes. So as you can see over here, I can show you the nodes and the internode very well over here. So if this is the main stem, you will see this is the node and this is the node. In between the two nodes, there is an internode. Okay, so that is how the stem is being divided into nodes and internodes. Now they are usually positive phototropic and negatively geotropic, and also negatively hydrotropic. Now again, what do you mean by positively phototropic? That means they grow towards the sunlight. So they become positively phototropic. When we say negatively geotropic and negatively hydrotropic, that means they do not grow towards the soil, or you can say they do not grow towards the water body. Okay, so they are negatively geotropic or negatively hydrotropic. Okay, and they also show different bud, the axillary bud, the apical bud, and the accessory bud. The main function of stem is to provide support, to give out branches, to bear some leaves, flowers, and fruits, and for the conduction of water and minerals through the vascular bundles, that is the xylem and the phloem. Okay, so now let us study about the modification in stems. So the first one in modification of stem is the underground stem. Now underground stem, which are also called as rhizomes, and it is mainly seen in ginger. Okay, the best example that I can give you is ginger. So ginger, it is an underground stem. So people just have a misconception that it is a root, but it is not a root, it is an underground stem. And these underground stems, they are called as rhizomes. Okay, so if you see, it grows horizontally and it has nodes and internodes. Okay, so the nodes, there are non-functional photosynthetic, they are non-functional leaves that are present. Okay, and the leaves are scaly. Okay, adventitious roots are produced from the nodes. So from the nodes, we will see it is a monocot. So you will see that adventitious roots are being produced from the nodes. Okay, now the axillary buds, they are present in the leaf exile. They produce new rhizomes which help in vegetative multiplication of the rhizome. And during favorable environmental conditions, the terminal buds, okay, the terminal buds, they produce aerial shoots, okay, that will bear certain stem, certain flowers. Okay, so the first one is underground stem or the rhizome. Now let us see the next one, that is the subaerial stem. Now what do you mean by subaerial stem? It means that certain part of these stems are above, that is above the ground level, and certain parts are below the ground levels. And the example for this is runner. Okay, runner, it is seen in Oxalis, it is seen in Cynodon Dictylon, and it is also seen in Centella. So Cynodon Dictylon, commonly which is called as dhoop grass. So students, you must have seen this dhoop grass growing. Now they have a slender stem developing from the axillary bud, okay, and they grow out in all directions. So if you have ever plucked a dhoop grass or cynodon, you will see that there is no one, you know, one grass coming in your hand. Okay, they will just come out in cluster form because they just grow in all directions and all of them are connected to each other. So if you pluck one, with that one grass, there will be others also which are plucked out. Okay, so they develop from the adventitious roots. So here you can see that there are adventitious roots that are growing at the nodes. Okay, then are the aerial stems. Now these are called the aerial stems, and it is seen in Opuntia, that is cactus, and commonly also called as nagfani. Now these aerial stems, they are called as phylloclads. Okay, so again, as I told you previously, that Opuntia or nagfani or cactus, they grow in xerophytic condition. That means the condition where there is no water or where there is less water. Now in such regions, these plants have to store their water for their future use. Okay, they have to restore their water. Now for the storage purpose, they have modified themselves, or they have modified the stems into these phylloclads. Okay, so you will see that there are no leaves. The leaves are being modified into thorns. Why are the leaves modified into thorns? They are modified into thorns so that they can prevent transpiration or they can prevent water loss. And all the water that is stored, it is stored in these phylloclads. Okay, so if you take a section or if you transversely cut these phylloclads, you will see a gel-like matrix inside. And that gel-like matrix will have a lot of water storage. Okay, again, if I give you an example of aloe vera, if you cut an aloe vera, the similar texture is seen in Opuntia. Okay, so if you see, these are the stems which are green in color so that they can perform the function of photosynthesis, and the leaves, they are being developed into these thorns, or they are being modified into thorns. Okay, now next, there is certain modification in leaves as well that is seen. The first one is phyllodes, it is seen in acacia. Okay, so what happens in acacia, the rachis of the bipinnately compound leaves, they become highly flattened and green phyllodes for photosynthesis. So these are the rachis that become flattened and they become green, which are called as phyllodes. Now this is for the function of photosynthesis. So phyllodes, they are different parts of the leaf like petiole, but which in this plant mentioned above, that is acacia, they turn flat and green. So this is actually the false leaf and this is the true leaf. Okay, this bipinnately compound structure, this is the true leaf. Now if you see this structure, they are small in size and after maturity they just fall off. Why do they fall off? They fall off because they have to prevent water loss, they have to prevent transpiration. So the false leaf, they appear like the true leaf, but they are not actually the true leaf, they are the petiole. Okay, then there is one modification, that is leaf tendrils. Now leaf tendrils, as a whole or a part of it, or it is associated part as a modified, they are modified into tendril. Okay, so there are certain leaves which are modified into tendrils. Okay, in weak stem plants, these tendrils, they are very supportive. They help in climbing. So in Lathyranthus, that is the wild pea, or Picum sativum, that is the garden pea, these leaf tendrils are seen. Okay, so students, this was about the modification of root, modification of stem, and modification of leaf. Now the part that we have covered just now, that is the modification of root, stem, and leaf, it is being reduced for this year. Okay, this portion is being reduced for this year, but still I've taught you this so that you have a better understanding. And we are stopping here today. We are stopping this session today, and in the next session we'll be moving to the next part of the angiosperm, that is the inflorescence, and we'll then take the chapter forward.